I'm going to briefly describe how to use this phase diagram for water. We're plotting the log of pressure on the y-axis, temperature on the x-axis, and then we have a bar graph that shows the relative amounts of each phase. So you can think of this as having 1 kilogram of water, and when we're at the point that corresponds to the black dot, we have all liquid. And I've selected upper left here isothermal, so the choices are isothermal or isobaric, and I want to look at vaporization carried out isothermally. So this essentially corresponds to changing the volume. That's how we can look at it. And of course we have to be putting energy in when we get to the phase change, but let's look at, as the volume changes, we approach the two-phase line, and now liquid's being converted to vapor, and we'll stay on this line. And if we click the box that shows the phase rule, we only have 1 degree of freedom, and we picked the 1 degree of freedom because we picked the temperature to carry out this isothermal process. This particular simulation just shows one example. It picks one temperature, but any temperature between the triple point temperature, where three phases exist, and the critical point temperature, the highest temperature where we can have vapor-liquid equilibrium, any point in between will show the same type behavior. We're converting liquid to vapor, and we stay on the line until, so as I increase the volume, we'll stay on the line. We put in energy to accomplish this. Now we have all vapor, then we move off the line, and we're basically expanding a vapor, and we do this against some resisting pressure, which means we'd be doing work and taking energy out of the system, and it means we have to add heat to keep us isothermal. Well, there's various other choices. One is sitting at the triple point temperature, and now as the volume changes, I hit the triple point. Now we have three phases present, and we're going to stay in this three phase point, that triple point. You see from the phase rule, we have no degrees of freedom. Where, remember, in this phase rule, P is the number of phases and C is the number of components, which in our case, water is the only component. And so this is the only point where three phases exist for water. As I continue to decrease the volume isothermally, obviously putting energy to vaporize, eventually all vapor, and then we have the same behavior we just saw. You can also carry out a process isobaric. So let's look at, do this, we want to look at melting. So we'll start with solid, and keeping the pressure constant, we'll heat up the solid, gets to the phase envelope, we start forming liquid. We're continuing to input energy. As we do that, we get more and more liquid. Once all the solid has melted, now we move off the line. We put in, add energy, we heat up the liquid, it gets hotter. We'll pick one more example. And let's look at isothermal melting, because now on the diagram, you notice we have an insert. This line is so steep. It has a negative slope, but it's so steep that we need the insert to show the behavior. And so as the volume is decreasing, we're talking about very small volume changes here. Looks like on the larger diagram we were already on the line, but we only are hitting the line here, and now we start forming solids. So constant temperature, we're lowering the pressure, the liquid converts to solid. Certainly we'd have to be taking energy out for this to happen, and eventually we have all solid and we've moved off the line. It doesn't look like we're off the line on the larger diagram, but on the expanded view you can see now we're below it and we're in the solid region. So the idea of this simulation is to show the behavior as we cross these various phase boundaries, either carrying them out isothermally or isobaric.